Il est temps maintenant de démarrer cette soirée et pour cela, je vous propose d'accueillir un activiste. Quelqu'un qui travaille au quotidien à nous faire prendre conscience de l'importance des défis qui nous font face. Il est advocate pour les objectifs de développement durable à l'ONU. Il est aussi expert auprès du World Economic Forum et membre du Boma Brain Trust. Je vous propose d'accueillir Marc Buckley. The stage is yours.
My fellow global citizens, brothers, sisters, and friends, I want you to know we're in a time of action. This is a decade of action, and the momentum has already begun. Most climate activists and speakers show you this, the blue marble, our second catalog image of our Earth, for a reason, to show you that there's no nations, no borders, no colors, no individual, that it is our common home. I want you to know that it is your home, it's my home, it's all of our home together, that we are unified and united as Homo sapiens, as a species moving in the same direction. But I show it to you for two other reasons. One reason is that 500 people have seen this image live from outer space, and they have had a profound effect and experience on their lives where it has touched them to the core. I want you to imagine and have this image and the journey of where we're going touch you to the core, but have you have inspiration, optimism, and great hope for what our future holds for us all. We've been shamed and admonished enough. We're on a journey to a beautiful, resilient, desirable future. Now, the real reason I show you this image is because why? Because we would not have this image had we had not gone to the moon and by accident turned back and looked at our Earth. Without emerging technologies and innovation, we would not have this beautiful image. This data, this emerging technology, the satellites give us live, up-to-the-date information to the second. We know what all the heart blood, the pulse of our planet, how it is reacting. That's through innovation and emerging technologies, and that's how we will create the resilient, desirable futures we all want to live in. This is my friend, Dr. Bertrand Piccard. He is the first man to fly around the world in a solar airplane. And he's the owner of 1,000 Solutions, a company that has 1,000 solutions to solve global grand challenges. This was in Katowice, Poland, COP24, the first time I saw him after his flight. I said to him, "How was it? How was it?" He said, "I felt like a rocket man. I felt like a man from the future, a futurist. And then I came to my senses. And when I came to my senses, I realized, no, I'm not from the future. I'm living in the now. I'm living in the present. I'm just the first to put all these technologies together and make them work. But solar panels and airplanes and these technologies have been around for a long time." He went to many, many shipbuilders or many, many airplane wing builders to get them to put solar panels on his wings. No one could do it. They all said, "It's impossible, it can't be done." He finally found a shipbuilder who builds sails, who made this airplane for him. And this is his message to the United Nations, to Ban Ki-moon, at the signing of the Paris Agreement.
"You know, Mr. Secretary General, what you are doing today in New York, signing the Paris Climate Agreement, is more than protecting the environment. It is the launch of the clean technology revolution. But there is so much resistance everywhere. So be pioneers, be adventurers, be explorers."
I want you to know that the signing of the Paris Agreement and the Sustainable Development Goals are the world's first ever global action plan, moonshot, earthshot. It's unheard of, unprecedented. For the first time in our world's history, we have 197 countries that came together and agreed on the Paris Agreement and signed it, and on the Sustainable Development Goals. That's crazy. That's a historical moment, let alone two countries trying to decide where they're going to go eat lunch, but 197 of them agreeing on a roadmap and action plan to save humanity for the future. Now, when we were presented with the Sustainable Development Goals, I have to apologize. This is how they were presented to us. From 1 to 17, laid out very linear and lateral. People didn't know what to expect. They didn't know what they were for. They thought, are these for cities, governments, corporations? I told someone I'm an advocate for the Sustainable Development Goals. They said, great, I like number one. It's red, my favorite color, no poverty. And I said, that is fabulous. But did you know it's virtually impossible to touch on one SDG goal and not touch on the others because they are all connected together in a system? If you were to try to work on number one, no poverty, you would immediately work on zero hunger, good quality in education, clean water and sanitation, production and consumption, responsible production and consumption, and many, many others, because they're all tied together in a system. Now, for the United Nations, because I apologize, I want to let you know that there is hope, and we have a dream and vision, and I created the UN Sustainable Development Goal Manifesto, and I'm going to read it to you. But before I do, I want you to either close your eyes or imagine yourself January 2030, what a world would look like if we achieved every one of these goals. Imagine a world where there is no poverty and zero hunger. We have good health and well-being, quality education, and gender equality everywhere. There is clean water and sanitation for everyone. Affordable and clean energy has created decent work and sustainable economic growth. Our prosperity is fueled by investments in resilient industry, innovation, and infrastructure. And that has reduced inequalities. We live in sustainable cities and communities, and responsible consumption and production has healed our planet. Climate action has stopped and reversed the warming of our planet, and we have flourishing life below water and abundant, diverse life on land. We enjoy peace and justice through strong institutions and have built long-term partnerships for the goals. Now that is a 2030, January 2030, that I want to live in. What that is a people prosperity protection plan, an insurance plan to create an infrastructure for all humanity. And it's what 197 countries signed off on. This is how we truly should view the Sustainable Development Goals, as a wedding cake or a pie. And the reason is because this bottom layer, our biosphere, is the absolute most important layer out of them all. Because without this layer of life on land, life below water, we cannot produce any product. We cannot produce cars, smartphones, or food. And we need this layer to really do anything. And that is why it is so important. And it's all related to us. It's related to our energy source and how we live and do anything for humanity. Now, we look at the world today and we say how we're producing things, how we're doing things that are really affecting our planet, and we really need to ask ourselves the burning question. And most of you probably think this is a bad word, but it's not. It's what's the future? That's the burning question. What is the future that we're creating for ourselves? That's the question that we need to ask each and every one of us. And I want to give you a scenario. little analogy. If you slow down or reduce your speed while driving on the highway in the wrong direction, you're only going slower in the wrong direction. Now, I want to explain that to you because there's a lot of cities and countries and governments and corporations that every year they release an annual report or a report saying, this year we're going to reduce our carbon emissions by 70%. We're going to go plastic free by 2030. We're going to reduce all our emissions by 80% this year. What are they telling you? Nothing. They're telling you they're going slower in the wrong direction. I want to put that in perspective for you. If the entire world today stopped and reversed their direction and went in a sustainable, resilient direction, that does not make this go away. Even though the whole world is doing great, all our plastic, all our pollution, all our greenhouse gas emissions are still here. Did you know that less than 1% of all plastic ever produced on our planet is still here on our planet? It's still floating around. That less than 1% that's not here, it's here in another form as a greenhouse gas because it was burned. All this pollution, greenhouse gas emissions, air pollution is still here. We need to go a step much further in the right direction. So when you throw it away, please think there is no way. We are all here together as Homo sapiens on this, our only home. We really need to have an ego shift from humans being at the top to an eco shift to see ourselves as an integral part of our planet. And here's where the hope and optimism and the momentum comes into play. September 2019, there was an ambition set by 87 companies. They set the ambition to reach the Paris Agreement to keep our planet below 1.5 degrees of warming and on the Sustainable Development Goals. And those 87 major companies have a market cap of $2.3 trillion. Now, that's a noble goal, and it sounds wonderful, like a big number. It's still not enough, but it's a step in the right direction. But here's where you really need to get excited. Exactly 11 days ago, Microsoft came out with a new ambition. And most of you maybe didn't hear this. $1 billion Climate Innovation Fund, very noble. Carbon negative, not neutral, but carbon negative by 2030. And here's the one that most people didn't understand. And it's the most important because it set a historical precedence. They're going to remove every carbon, historical carbon emission that they've ever put into our world by 2050. That means since they've been in business, whatever the effect they've had on our planet, they're going to remove it. Now that is a precedence because I guarantee you Apple, Google, Amazon are going to jump on board and they're probably going to say $1 trillion. But they're also going to say, since we've been on business, everything that we've affected this planet, we're going to get rid of our historical carbon. Now, my wish and dream and desire would be is that Coca-Cola, Nestle, Pepsi would jump on board and said, every plastic bottle that we put into this world, since we've been in business, we're going to remove that historical emission and pollution. That would be the step in the right direction. And we can do it. And here is a nice wish for you all. You may say I'm a dreamer, but I'm not the only one. I hope someday you'll join us. And the world. So that was a deep fake, but just like we can get fake news and bad Twitters and bad news, we can put a spin in the right direction, a wish, of the desirable future that we want to live in. If you know John Lennon's Imagine song, there is no better song in the world that tells us what to envision for our future. And that's why I wrote the manifesto, because I want you to have a dream and a vision and a feel what it will be like to live January 2030 on this planet. We reach all those things. I offer you a challenge for your personal life, for your business, for your communities. Please set an ambition to reach the Sustainable Development Goals and to take a step in the right direction to clean up our planet and leave it better than we found it, and to obey the golden rule. Please treat people and our planet how you would like to be treated. And I think that's how we can become global citizens and keep the momentum going in the right direction.
Thank you.
Thank you. No question. Thank you.